some introduction to the topic, and then John will lead us through the hands-on session. So I'll give an intro to Science DMC, which I think is the most interesting aspect of network security in cyber infrastructure right now. What the particular network security challenges are for the Science DMC, and how we're addressing those challenges right now with some research projects around intelligence sharing between Science DMC instances, and then we'll have the hands-on related to the intelligence sharing. So before I talk about a Science DMC, I should talk about DMZ in general. So DMZ in networking, probably many of you are already familiar with the term, it's the demilitarized zone of your network, where you're going to put the services that are accessed from users outside of your organization. And so the web server is the perfect example of that, where you put the web server out on the DMZ, but you've got a strong firewall protecting your critical services that are on your intranet for your enterprise. And so the Science DMZ takes that same approach, recognizing that a lot of the collaborative science cyber infrastructure also needs to be outside of the university's main firewall, particularly for performance reasons, but also because it needs to be accessible by researchers that are collaborating with the researchers on campus, and they're coming from other campuses or from around the world. And so this is a slide provided by ESNet, the network, the high performance research network provider for the Department of Energy and the Department of Energy Office of Science. And they're the ones who really innovated or came up with this term of Science DMZ. And so they talk about the key components of Science DMZ that you need. First, you need the friction-free network path. You can't have slow firewalls in the way of your multi-gigabit data transfers when you're pulling lots of petabytes we were getting out of the telescope, and you need to get that data onto your campus so that you can start doing some local data analysis using your campus high performance compute cluster on it. You can't be going through a slow firewall for that. And so having a good wide area network path that's on the edge of your network in the DMZ zone really enables that scientific research. And then in addition to that friction-free network path, you need the data nodes, the data transfer nodes that can handle parallel transfers and optimize TCP transfers with large window sizes so that you can move a lot of data and use the network efficiently. And so a common software that's used today across universities for these research data transfers is called Globus. And so we'll hear a lot about that at different conferences that we attend related to the Science DMZs. And then you need to, of course, monitor your infrastructure and have the ability to diagnose problems that are happening on your network on campus or in the wide area. And an important tool for instrumenting your network is called Perf Sonar. That's out of Berkeley Lab, I believe. And so I'll show some screenshots from Perf Sonar, but we're all deploying Perf Sonar nodes on our campuses that do network testing between them. And so it gives us really useful network diagnostics, not just for cybersecurity, but also for general network performance tuning. And also, I shouldn't forget the last bullet about the importance of engagement with the scientists. They have to be aware that the data transfer node in Science DMZ is out there, and because that's where the large data can be stored and the fast data transfers can happen. Probably they're not going to have the gigabit speed to their office in many cases, and so knowing that this resource is out there, that's where the computing and the data can be access together for better performance. And so here are some snapshots of our Perf Sonar node at NCSA, where we're constantly monitoring our high performance, wide area connectivity to other supercomputing centers in the United States, NSF centers, and Department of Energy labs in particular, because those are where a lot of the big data transfers are happening for our scientists. So the since the Science DMZ is really about big data, that's where a lot of the big cybersecurity challenges come from. If you just naively put the Science DMZ out there and your researchers start moving the big telescope images or the big images from the laser interferometer, from the Large Hadron Collider, and their massively parallel data transfers, and they're, you're pulling in images from labs around the world, it starts to look like a denial of service attack on your network. And so being able to have the intelligence about what's happening on your network so you can distinguish between the good traffic and the bad traffic, and give the fast lane to the good traffic so your scientists can be efficient in their work. And it's important to operate the open, your network as an open facility, because you want to enable the research collaboration. You don't want to be putting roadblocks in front of your researchers on campus, and because then they'll work around you. And also, in addition to just moving data around, in a lot of cases on the Science DMZ is access to high performance computing. That is would be pretty attractive to malicious parties wanting to have some nodes to launch DOS attacks. That's a lot of processors, a lot of high speed networks, and Bitcoin mining, and lots of malicious use cases for the resources that we're putting out there in the DMZ part of the network. So we need to be particularly careful about protecting those resources. So the good news is that a lot of organizations are deploying these Science DMZs with similar type services, LOBUS and Perf Sonar, and data transfer nodes and high performance computing nodes. And so we can share intelligence between them to help us all protect our Science DMZ instances more effectively. And so just like the research is happening across universities, we can have collaborations around our regional cybersecurity. And so we've got a research project right now at NCSA that is automating that intelligence sharing across Science DMZ nodes, and so that if you're seeing a malicious event at one Science DMZ node and then a second and a third, that's going to give you a level of confidence where you can block it at your own node automatically in a lot of cases. And so the result is that you're enhancing the security of the Science DMZ model. In many cases, you're providing sufficient security to convince your campus security officer that this is a model you can actually support on campus. That can get you from saying, no, there's no way I'm willing to put this outside of the campus firewall, to yes, I see that you're putting in these additional cybersecurity controls. And so in that case, we can open up more of the network access, more of the high performance access, and enable the use that we want to enable the business case. And so I'm going to go through an intelligence sharing example, and then you'll see it in action in the hands-on exercise. So one of the ways that researchers will access the Science DMZ is through SSH, so that they can log in and access data directly and submit high-performance computing jobs. But of course, if you're opening up your SSH access to connections from around the world, then you can have brute force connection attempts, people trying to crack into the accounts and misuse your resources. So in this case, if you've got three sites that have Science DMZs and site C sees a brute force attack attempt from a particular IP address, that site can alert other sites in the intelligence sharing network. So then when the second site sees it, that site can notice that this is a similar event and share that alert with higher confidence. Now we're starting to see a trend, an attacker that's hitting multiple network instances with a similar type attack, and so then you can begin to automatically block that attack across the collaborating group of Science DMZs. So with that introduction, I'll hand it over to John to take us through the hands-on exercise. Great.